the six harmonious unities of the Sangha. These pictures were assembled together as a Sangha. Sangha is a Sanskrit word which means harmoniously united assembly. They live together without bickering or fighting and are united in terms of phenomena and nomina. In terms of the nominal aspect, they have given proof to liberation and to the unconditioned. In terms of the phenomena, they are united in six ways. As a harmonious group, they dwell together. They don't look at one another's phones and fight among themselves. No one has a special style. There are, for example, no solitary drinkers or smokers out of harmony with the rest. Everyone who lives with the Sangha must abide the Sangha's rules. With harmonious speech, they do not quarrel, they don't gossip, they don't say, so-and-so has such and such an asset, and so-and-so has such and such a fault. Three frogs have six eyes. Their speech is harmonious and what they talk about is important and has principle. They don't argue. With harmonious thoughts, they enjoy the same things. One person likes to study the Buddha Dharma and so does the next. One is vigorous and the next is even more so. The more one person cultivates, the more the next cultivates. Everyone makes vigorous progress. Every day they are more energetic, not more lazy. Cultivating more and speak less, their minds are in harmony. With harmonious views, they have the same liberation. With the same precepts, they cultivate together. In harmony, they mutually share their benefits. 1250 in all, these were the Buddha's constant followers, his retainers. When the Buddha went to lecture sutras, these arhats always went along, even if they had already heard the sutra. There were actually 1,255 disciples, but for the sake of convenience, the number was rounded off to 1,250. Where did the disciples come from? In the deer park, the Buddha first taught the five bhikshus, then Yasas, the son of an elder, and his 49 disciples took refuge. The Venerable Shariputra and the Venerable Mahamudga Dhyayana each had 100 disciples who took refuge. That makes 255. The Kashyapa brothers had 1,000 disciples, making 1,255, and rounded off 1,250 in all. The Kashyapa brothers. The three Kashyapa brothers had 1,000 disciples. 500 were with Uruvilva Kashyapa. Uruvilva means papaya grove, for it is said that he cultivated in a papaya grove. Some accounts claim that he had a lump on his chest which resembled a papaya, some describing it as concave and some as convex. What is probable is that, liking to eat papayas, he cultivated in a papaya grove, and in time a papaya grew on his chest. Papayas are good for curing illnesses of the lungs. Aruvilva Kashyapa, who had two brothers, Gaya meaning city or elephant head mountain, and Nadi, meaning river. The two brothers had 500 disciples between them, and so the three brothers had a total of 1,000 disciples. The Buddha first taught and crossed over the five bhikshus in the deer park. Then he considered who to cross over next, seeing that the potential of the three Kashyapa brothers had matured. He went to the dwelling of Uruvilva Kashyapa. He could not, however, simply say, "I have come to save you, Uruvilva Kasyapa." Do you believe that? He had to employ a clever expedient device, and so he said, "It's late and I can't travel any further. May I stay on here?" Uruvilva Kasyapa, a powerful fire worshipper, saw the Buddha and thought, "Why is he so special?" Try as he might, he couldn't figure the Buddha out. Strange, he thought, I can see anyone else's background just by looking. Why can't I see his? Finally, he said to the Buddha, "Very well, you may stay here." And he put him in a cave where Uruvilva Kasyapa's protector, a dragon, lived. The dragon was extremely fierce and scorched them to death anyone who came near him. In the middle of the night, the dragon tried to burn the Buddha, but the Buddha had entered the firelight samadhi and couldn't be burned. The Buddha put the dragon in his bowl. More than likely, he didn't have to trick him by saying, "You can only make fire, you can't jump into my bowl." As the sixth patriarch would later speak to another dragon, "You can only manifest a big body, not a small one." The Buddha used a very natural method to get the dragon into his bowl. Then he explained the Dharma to him and the dragon took refuge. Seeing such spiritual penetrations and transformation, Kasyapa knew that his own virtue was not as great as the Buddha's. Thereupon, he took refuge and instructed his 500 disciples to do the same. Soon after leaving home, they gave proof to the sage leaf fruit. Kasyapa's two brothers were also fire worshippers, but when they saw that their brother had become a bhikshu, they wanted to leave home as well. They did, and along with their 500 disciples, they soon gave proof to the sage leaf fruit. That makes 1,255 disciples. Out of gratitude for the Buddha's deep kindness and his teaching, they were the Buddha's constant followers. No matter where the Buddha went, they accompanied him and protected the assembly. For example, here we lecture on the sutras, and those who come to listen protect the assembly. Even though they already understand the doctrines, they still take time from their busy schedules to come and listen. All great arhats whom the assembly knew and recognized. Arhat, a Sanskrit word, has three meanings which correspond to the three meanings of the word bhikshu, because being a bhikshu is the cause of attaining arhatship, and an arhatship is the result of cultivation as a bhikshu. It's a matter of cause and effect. And an arhat is worthy of offerings. On the causal ground, a bhikshu is a seeker of aims for food, and in the result, he is worthy of the offerings of gods and men. One without birth, a bhikshu frightens Mara, and in the result, as an arhat, he undergoes no further birth. A slayer of thieves, on the causal ground, a bhikshu destroys evil, and in the result, as an arhat, he has slain the thieves of ignorance and affliction. On the causal ground, the bhikshu frightens the demons of the five skandhas, the afflictions and death. Death is also a demon. Some cultivators practice diligently, yet when they fall back and confront death, they are afraid. "I'm going to die," they cry, turned by the demon of death. Real cultivators fear nothing. They are not afraid of life and they are not afraid of death. Life and death are the same. Death and life are not different. There is no distinction between them. If while alive, cultivators can be as if dead, they will have no thoughts of desire. How can one have desire, greed, hatred, stupidity, pride, and doubt as a dead man. When one arrives at this state, there are no afflictions, no troubles at all. This is true happiness. This state is not easy to attain, however. On the other hand, it is not difficult either. If you want to, you can do it. For example, when one of my disciples became extremely sick, he said to me repeatedly, "I'm really suffering." I said, "The more suffering you undergo, the better. The more you suffer, the more you will understand." One day, it seemed as if he had died. He went to a happy face for a pupil. "Happiness is happiness," he said, "but I want to see my teacher." "Who is your teacher?" the pupil asked. As soon as they heard his teacher's name, they were unhappy. "You can't see your teacher here," they said. "Then I'm leaving," he said, and came back. He didn't die after all. You might say he has conquered the demon of death. Subsequently, his skill has increased greatly. Whom the assembly knew and recognized, these Arhats were all very famous, and their virtue was respected by the entire population. Everyone knew their names and recognized their faces. The assembly of Arhats Sutra. Elders Shariputra, Mahamudgalayana, Mahakasyapa, Mahakatiyayana, Mahakausthila, Rivata, Sudipantaka, Nanda, Ananda, Rahula, Gavampati, Bindola, Bharatvaya, Kalodeyin, Mahakavina, Vakula, Aniruddha, and others such as these, all great disciples. Commentary. Elder is a term used to show respect for another's position. There are three kinds of elders. Elders in age, elders in the Dharma nature, elders in blessings and virtue. An elder in age has lived for many years. A Dharma nature elder understands the Buddha Dharma and comprehends his self nature. Regardless of his age, he is nonetheless an elder in terms of his wisdom and intelligence. One such as this may be young in years, but he can lecture on sutras and speak the Dharma. His wisdom is limitless and his eloquence is unobstructed. Elders in blessings and virtue are fortunate because people like to make offerings to them. Because of their virtuous conduct, they are folds where, by making offerings, one plants the causes of future blessings. Shariputra. Shariputra was a Dharma nature elder. At the age of 8, he studied and mastered all the Buddha Dharma in only 7 days, and he could not debate all the Indian philosophers. His name is Sanskrit. His father's name was Tisya, and his mother's name was Sakira. Hence, he was known as Upatisya, little Tisya, and as Sariputra, the son Putra of Sari. The word Sariputra may be translated three ways. Baby son, because his mother's body was extremely beautiful and her features very defined. Ingrate son, due to his mother's eyes, which was beautiful as an ingrate and jewel son, because her eyes shone like jewels. Shariputra's mother's eyes were beautiful, and when he bore this jeweled eye on, his eyes were beautiful too. He was the foremost of the Sravakas in wisdom. While still in the womb, he replied to his mother's debate, and so she always won. In the past, whenever she had debated with his brother, he had always lost. But while she was pregnant with Sariputra, her brother, always lost. "This isn't your own power," I said. "The child in your womb must be incredibly intelligent. He's helping you debate, and that's why I lost." Thereupon, he decided to logic, and traveled to southern India, where the Buddha's for many years. There was no electricity at that time yet, but he studied day by day and by night. He mastered the four Vedas and the classics of Indian knowledge without wasting a moment. He didn't take him to mend his tattered clothing, wash his face, and went to cut his nails, which grew so long that everyone called him the long-nailed Brahmin. Having mastered various philosophical theories, he returned to debate with his sister's son. He had spent a great deal of time preparing for the events and felt that if he lost, it would be the height of disgrace. Where are you? "Where is your son?" he asked his sister. "Sariputra has left home life under the Buddha," she said. The long-nailed Brahmin was dispelled. "How could he?" he said. "What virtue does the Buddha have? He's just a Sramara. Why should anyone follow him? I'm going to go bring my nephew back." He went to the Buddha and demanded his nephew, but the Buddha said, "Why do you want him back? You can't just casually walk off with him. Establish your principles and I'll consider your request." "I take non-accepting as my doctrine," said the uncle. "Really?" said the Buddha. "Do not accept your view of non-accepting. Do you accept your doctrine or not?" Now, the uncle had just said that he didn't accept anything, but when the Buddha asked him when or not he accepted his own nephew of non-accepting, he could hardly admit he accepted it, for that would invalidate his doctrine as non-appearance. But if he said that he didn't accept it, he would contradict his own statement of his doctrine and his views. He was therefore unable to answer either way. Before the debate, he had made an agreement with the Buddha that if he won, he would take his nephew, but if he lost, he said that he would cut off his head and give it to the Buddha. The uncle had bet his head and lost. So what did he do? He ran. About 4 miles down the road, he stopped and thought, "I can't run away." I thought the Buddha that if I lost, I told the Buddha that if I lost, he could have my head. I'm a man after all, and I should keep my word. It's unmanly to run away. Then he returned to Shakyamuni Buddha and said, "Give me a knife. I'm going to cut off my head." "What for?" said the Buddha. "I lost, didn't I? I owe you my head, don't I?" he said. "There's no such principle in my Dharma," said the Buddha. "Had you won, you could have taken your nephew. But since you lost, why don't you leave home instead?" "Will you accept me?" he said. "Yes," replied the Buddha. Not only did the nephew not return, but the uncle didn't return home either. At age 8, the great wise Sariputra had penetrated the real mark of all dharmas in only 7 days and defeated all the philosophers in India. When Shakyamuni Buddha spoke the Amitabha Sutra without request, Sariputra was at the head of the assembly, because only wisdom such as his could comprehend the deep, wonderful doctrine of the Pure Land Dharma Door. Not only Was he foremost in wisdom? He was not second in spiritual penetrations either. Once a layman invited the Buddha to receive offerings, Shariputra had entered Samadhi, and no matter how they called him, he wouldn't come out. He wasn't being obnoxious by showing off, thinking, "I hear them, but I'm not moving. That's all there is to it." No, he had really entered Samadhi. When he didn't respond to the bell, Maudgalyayana, foremost in spiritual powers, applied every bit of strength he had, but couldn't move him. He couldn't even ruffle the corner of his robe. This proves that Shariputra was not only number one in wisdom, but also in spiritual penetrations. He wasn't like us. If someone bumps us while we sit in meditation, we know it. Shariputra had real samadhi. We should look into this. Why was Shariputra foremost in wisdom? Why was he called the greatly wise Shariputra? It's a matter of cause and effect in a former life in the causal ground. When he first decided to study, he met a teacher who asked him, "Would you like to be intelligent?" "Yes, I would," said Shariputra. "Then study the Dharma door of prana wisdom, recite the great compassion mantra, the Suragama mantra, the 10 small mantras, and the heart mantra. Recite them every day and your wisdom will unfold." Shariputra followed his teacher's instructions and recited day and night. While standing, sitting, walking, and reclining, he didn't recite for just one day, but made a vow to recite continuously, to bow to his teacher, and to study the Buddha Dharma life after life. Life after life, he studied prana, and life after life, his wisdom increased until when Shakyamuni Buddha appeared in the world. Shariputra was able to penetrate the real mark of all dharmas in only 7 days. Who was his former teacher? Just Shakyamuni Buddha. When Shakyamuni Buddha realized Buddhahood, Shariputra became an arhat, and because he obeyed his teacher, he had great wisdom. He never forgot the doctrines his teacher taught him, and so in 7 days, he mastered all the Buddha's dharmas. When one has not studied very much Buddha dharma in the past, when one's mantras are sutras slowly, one may recite the Suragama mantra for months and still be unable to recite it from memory. It is most important, however, not to be lazy. Be vigorous and diligent, like Shariputra. Don't relax day or night. Those who can't remember should study hard, and those who can should increase their efforts and enlarge their wisdom. You should consider, why is my wisdom so much less than everyone else? Why is his wisdom so lofty and mine so unclear? Why do I understand so little? It's because I haven't studied the Buddha Dharma. Now that we have met the Dharma, we should vow to study it. Then in the future, we can run right past Shariputra and study with the great wise Bodhisattva Manjushri, who is far, far wiser than the Arhat Shariputra. This is the cause behind Shariputra's wisdom, a useful bit of information. Three Americans, Ramanura and two Americans, Ramanurika, have now received the complete precepts, Ramanura, Bhikshu, the Bodhisattva precepts. You could say that they are new Bodhisattvas returning to America. People who have received the Bodhisattva precepts cultivate the Bodhisattva way, and people who have received the Bhikshu precepts upon the Buddha Dharma and teach living beings. When these five return from Taiwan, we Americans should protect them as precious treasures. All of you should be their Dharma protectors, for they are returning to America to establish American Buddhists so that in the future Americans will be able to cultivate and realize Buddhahood. This is my hope.